Knock, knock.
Is that you, Death?
It's Britta.
Oh.
Before you speak, I just want to tell you that you don't have to give me anything. I'm happy to just spend time with you. You know what Dylan Thomas said about Death?
No, tell me.
Okay, bluff called.
Britta, you're the selfless one in the group, right?
Wouldn't know. I haven't thought about myself in years.
So who is Britta? Britta's a lot of things. In a show like this, with 6 seasons and the first 3 seasons containing 20-plus episodes each, there's a lot of space for development, and we get to know a lot about all the characters. So in this analysis, we're just honing in on one of her major aspects, her socio-political identity, which is much more pronounced in Britta than in the other characters. The other characters don't really even get into that very much. And like most people, political categories and talking points don't really define them.
You know, you gotta ask yourself right now, Abed, what's up with politics?
Yeah, yeah, you're precisely right, Troy.
As the show goes on, Britta reveals clearly that she's what one might think of as a pre-Trump leftist. Twitter and the non-stop presence of Donald Trump changed everything.
What do you mean everything?
Everything!
Scary got scarier. Crazy got crazier. It's like someone dropped acid in the punch and everyone was drinking it for 4 years.
You mean everyone?
So you're not ruling anything out.
Good morning, Sunday morning.
And then the final solution, which is a year to 2 years off, is the vaccines.
Maybe we shouldn't call the vaccine the final solution.
Guess what?
Caitlin's preggers too. Yeah, baby.
Wait, what?
But this is before all that. So Britta is interesting because she's in a way very familiar and yet antiquated. She's what they once called a bleeding heart liberal. The characterization goes something like this. An activist type that did plenty of drugs, watched Democracy Now, traveled a lot, and was always very concerned with some injustice in some distant part of the world.
What are you doing?
There's rioting in Tunisia.
The Cape is premiering.
Humanity is premiering, you jags.
Liberal, worldly, and well-informed.
Vacations are wasted on the young. You guys gotta get out there and see the world at some point, or you're gonna miss your entire lives.
Where did you go, Britta?
Amsterdam, I think. I'll know more when I find my camera.
Britta has the mentality that was nicely exemplified in 1999's Battle in Seattle.
Look it up.
And the movement to free Tibet from the brutality of the CCP. This was back when you would hear the word empathy a lot.
I am the Tibetan nun who was incarcerated in your prison. I have too have been subject to the torture. You strip us naked. You torture us. You sexually violate us. You pour boiling water over our skins. This torture we know is going on to this day. This is part of your present policy.
Just last month, monks from the Ganden Monastery outside a plaza peacefully demonstrated. You shot them down in the street, and you imprisoned, you threw more into concentration camps.
Britta is the spirit of the ones that used to care about this issue. So Britta loves causes. She loves protesting. She loves finding a reason to fight the power.
I'm out of date a minute. The whole world will be watching this on the first of next month!
She's passionate and outspoken. She's an atheist. She's a vegetarian. She's promiscuous. She's always sneaking off to smoke weed.
Well, I wouldn't know. I'm a vegetarian.
Shocker. Yeah.
And if you guys knew how they treated the animals that you were eating, you would eat them even faster just to put them out of their misery. And then you would throw up.
The lady doth protest too much, methinks.
And there's a lot of funny little details about Britta, too, that just make sense in some way. Like how the one episode where she's into black and white photography, but at the same time really bad at it.
Unfortunately for Britta and millions of photographers like her, just because something is in black and white doesn't mean it's good.
In the aforementioned Advanced Dungeons & Dragons, an episode which almost entirely consists of a D&D game played in the imaginations of the characters, Britta has some priceless moments.
And this is a local elf tavern, but all races are welcome.
Aww.
Okay, it's a crowded and rowdy evening. Beleaguered gnomes hurry to and fro with glasses of mead for the thirsty elves.
Beleaguered? Why are they beleaguered?
Who cares? I find a waiter and introduce myself.
Arky barky, arg bark bark.
Why is he a pirate? He's a gnome. He only speaks gnome. Anybody here speak gnome?
Oh, I do. Lavernica does.
Well, this'll be painless.
Hello, my friend and brother.
How can I help you, dear madam?
Oh, please, no need for such deference. I'm no better than a gnome.
Yes, you are, madam. You are a human warrior, which is 5 species classes greater than I.
That's disgusting. Don't talk like that.
I am so sorry, madam. Please don't report me for execution.
Oh, no, I didn't mean that. Guys, we've got to do something about these gnomes.
Britta, ask the stupid gnome where we can get a Pegasus.
The only overtly political episode, Season 2's Introduction to Political Science, is actually more about Annie and Jeff, and a very pessimistic view of the political system.
My name is Annie Edison, and if elected, I promise to make Greendale the signature community college of the entire western three quarters of the Greendale area.
Oh! Looks like you're in the running, Annie. Looks like it is hard not to be.
My name is Jeff. I'm no politician. I'm just a fella. I think that beer should be cold and boots should be dusty. I think 9/11 was bad. And freedom? Well, I think that's just a little bit better.
Next up.
I'm sorry, I got the heat. I gotta go. I believe that humankind need not be governed.
I don't care.
Well, it's good to know there's a floor on this thing, so. Thank you, Miss Perry!
Another notable trait is that Britta somehow finds suffering and victimization attractive. And this attribute has some very funny results.
Oh, is this a bad time?
Yeah. Gentlemen, there's no way to treat a girl that looks this way.
This plays out in 2 different episodes. First, she meets Luca, a friend of Troy and Abed's from the Balkans, and falls hard for him as soon as she finds out he has a violent and troubled past.
I'm from the Balkans. There are many things I try not to talk about.
Luca, I knew it. I knew there was pain in there. Just so you know, you can talk to me about anything.
So much killing.
Then in another episode, she's taking an acting class with Troy. The class is all about method acting, and they are taught that evoking pain from one's past is the crux of all good acting.
Dig in, immortalize, something hurt you.
I was captain of my high school football team. It was very hard being popular.
Then it's revealed that Troy was abused as a child.
I've always felt somehow ignored, almost invisible. Like, every time I go to say something, somebody just...
My uncle put his finger in my no-no!
After this, Britta suddenly finds herself very attracted to him.
My mouth... See you tomorrow.
But both of these plots are comically subverted. First, it's revealed that Luca was actually the aggressor in the violent conflict he was speaking of.
The river's red with their blood. I miss it so much.
Wait, just to clarify, when you say that you miss it, it's like you have survivor's guilt, like you wish you were back over there defending the motherland, right?
Yes, I miss cleansing our fields and forests of the unclean people who stole my country. I miss the smell of the villages burning. I miss the way they used to run from our tanks in fear.
And Troy admits that he made up his childhood abuse story to fit in.
Yeah, about that. I wasn't so much molested as much as I made it up.
What?
We're gonna laugh so hard about this later. My uncle never stuck his finger in my plop-plop. I know, I'm bummed about it too. I'm sorry, I want to be interesting. I want to fit in with you guys. I want to be able to be an actor.
The pain of not having enough pain. Still pain, young man.
Though your flirtation technique is hilarious, it's distracting. Luca is kicking serious ass right now. He just set fire to a farmer's market.
Bang, bang, your dick! Save your tears for your dog mother in hell!
Come on, I'm Dean, and my hands are so clean. At this moment, I am stay-falling.
Another Britta characteristic is that she loves telling you that the thing that you enjoy is actually bad.
Oh, Shirley, these pictures are adorable and comprehensive, but did you know that sugar is like baby meth? That's what my homeopath said.
Well, maybe your gay friend should mind his own business.
When's our culture gonna outgrow this wedding thing? You're anti-wedding now?
Oh, she's just pro-anti.
Note everything you both said. Weddings are like little girls' tea parties, except the women are the stuffed animals, the men are making them talk, and they're not drinking tea. They're drinking antiquated gender roles.
Somebody tell Britta what an analogy is.
I know what it is. It's like a thought with another thought's hat on.
I think my mom might visit this weekend. She and I are gonna get makeovers at that spa.
Makeovers? They sure have us programmed right. I am a female pleasure unit. I require a new coat of paint.
Just something I thought might be fun.
Here's something I think might be fun. Let's find out the number of makeup companies that are owned by women. I'll save you the trouble. It's zero. But of course you're saying, Britta, aren't you a hypocrite? You're plastered with glitter and goo from head to toe, just like the rest of us. Well, I also pay income tax and pull over for cops, but that doesn't mean I support a country that oppresses its citizens and restricts voting rights. You guys know Jesus was born in the middle of April, right? The church moved his birthday to December so they could steal the solstice from the pagans.
Season's greetings from Britta Perry.
Shirley, that is full of chemicals. I wouldn't expose your baby to that.
Actually, my doctor said an acid is safe to take.
But let me guess who paid for that study. Big antacid. Shirley, chew on a eucalyptus root and, I know it sounds gross, pig saliva. It's the same active ingredient as an acid. They just dress it up with a fancy name.
How dare they?
And for this tendency, they all give her the title, the worst.
What does it matter, you know? We're both just humans trying to make our way through this crazy world.
You're the worst.
What?
And for the record, I never thought you were cool. I only thought you were a lesbian.
So animal.
You're the worst.
How are we any better than them? You're the worst. Okay, she is just saying that to fit in.
I may have been thrown off by Britta's pronunciation of the word bagel.
How do you pronounce bagel?
I don't.
Come on.
Bagel.
Ugh, you're the worst. You are human tennis elbow. You are a pizza burn on the roof of the world's mouth. You are the opposite of Batman.
Everyone hates Britta.
In fact, this becomes such a theme that the other members of the group start jokingly using her name as a verb meaning to ruin or to mess up.
You probably just Britted the test results somehow.
No, I double-checked them. Wait, are people using my name to mean make a small mistake?
Yes.
Britta, look at the arrow. You ran these through the machine upside down.
She Britted it.
Whatever. I'll run them through again. And you guys are gonna stop using my name to mean making a tiny and understandable mistake.
Britta, you've done enough, okay? Why don't you go start a ruiners club? Oh, wait. Probably just ruin it.
Well, then I'd be doing a good job because it's a ruiners club.
You ruined my analogy.
We learned an important lesson tonight. We should never make the Britta of Britta-ing each other's feelings.
You're using it wrong.
Wow, you Britta'd Britta'd.
Yeah, way to pull an Abbott.
This sounds a bit severe, but really it's not actually mean-spirited. You have to remember that it's all in the context of friendship. It's satirical criticism. It's characterization. It's pointing out absurdities, but it's not mean-spirited. The audience likes Britta. And the other characters like Britta too. even if she is the worst.
Miso Christmas, Miso Merry!
Stop, stop, stop! What are you doing? Get off the stage!
I'm singing my heart song!
Get off the stage and never sing again! You are the worst!
Hey! You do not get to call Britta the worst.
Mr. Ramson, I think it's fine. Now, Greendale is an all-inclusive school. Why don't we let Britta sing her awkward song? Yeah!
There is a brilliancy in which all of her flaws are shown without judgment being cast.
How long does peyote last? Just asking for a friend.
There's also a great balance of intensity and lightness in Gillian Jacobs' performance.
Pizza! Pizza, pizza, in my tummy. Me so hungry, me so hungry.
And it looks like she was allowed to be herself in a way which really keeps the character unique. And although she exemplifies this abrasive and mean-spirited activist, social justice warrior type,
you're monsters! You're Hitlers! You're racist pedophiles! You're the opposite of Batman!
Her character goes well beyond those issues. Like in the episode when the carnival comes to town, and with it one of Britta's exes.
I have an ex-boyfriend that travels with a carnival. Fine. I'm not ashamed of my past, and if it entertains you guys, that's great, because we're friends. His name is Blade, and...
Or the episode when she falls in love with Subway.
Any business operating for profit on Greendale's campus must be at least 51% owned by a registered Greendale student!
That's too bad, Dean. I don't recall seeing Subway in my premenopausal post-feminist experiential marketing class.
Actually, I'm on the wait list for the pre-men post-fem X mark.
Who are you?
Gang, meet Greendale's newest student, Subway.
Your name is Subway.
Yep. Using a groundbreaking but surprisingly legal process known as corpohumanization, real people such as myself are now allowed to represent the collective humanity of business owners. I have contractually waived my birth identity and am now a man and students named Subway.
I don't believe this. Come on, Subway, there is no way you're 5'10".
Or the time that Subway came back later as an undercover Honda operative paid by Honda to influence people to buy more Hondas.
We can be a couple in a relationship in public. We can walk down the street holding hands.
If I take a job tricking people into buying things they don't want.
Do you enjoy billboards and commercials, Miss Perry?
You mean shillboards and commercials? No, I don't.
I detest them. They are unmanned bulldozers rolling over everything in their path. What Rick does is surgical.
CRV, you say?
CRV.
CRV.
Amazing.
You're amazing.
Honda's amazing. They can advertise things without you knowing? Is that legal? Sounds like brain windexing.
She's also just struggling to grow up in a world where the normal roles of youth and adulthood have faded, have changed.
Guys, watch this. Can I borrow $150?
No.
See? Now who's gonna come with me and show this guy what's up? I'll pay you back.
I'll get it from your parents.
Tell them I spit on their wealth and thank you. You can't expel Britta. She's been here 6 years. Three more and she'll have her 2-year degree.
So yeah, there's a lot of great Britta. But one of the best and most interesting of Britta's plot lines comes in the truly great and truly greatly underrated episode, criminally underrated episode, Geography of Global Conflict, the Model UN episode, in which Annie's nemesis, Annie Kim, steals her idea to form a Model UN. And so the presence of two Model UNs leads to the first and probably only Model UN off. This episode actually has some very great Annie moments as well.
You okay, kiddo?
Yeah. You know what's funny? This is so silly. Remember little Annie Kim from Poli Sci? Boy, she just took my Model UN idea and just... She is quite the little go-getter.
Wait, what? She stole your idea?
Well, the real important thing is that there is a Model UN. It doesn't really matter who starts it. It just means her name goes on some charter and she gets to put it on her resume.
and lead the Greendale team to the National Model UN, and meet Kofi Annan, Boutros Boutros-Ghali, and will.i.am.
Boutros Boutros-Ghali?
So, the key to winning this thing is, when in doubt, agree with Annie.
That's sweet, Jeff, but everyone should just have fun. Then again, what's more fun than winning?
It's an all-around great episode, with a classic Abed-driven outside-the-box, fourth-wall-breaking ending, and a funny and accurate analysis of the ineffectual nature of the UN thrown in for good measure. But let's go back to the beginning of the episode. Britta finds out some news about an old acquaintance.
Read the Damascus 3.
Oh, thanks. Whoa! I know this girl. We used to protest together all the time, and now she's locked up in Syria.
Oh, that's terrible.
Yes, it's terrible. She's imprisoned by an oppressive regime halfway around the world, and I'm what, in college? Where are my values? Man, she's got a Facebook group?
This triggers some kind of weird envy in Britta, and leads to this little tantrum.
You're the best, kiddo.
You know what else was the best? The rainforest. Too bad the fascist oligarchies are raping them to make hamburgers. Look it up.
Looks like someone woke up on the regular side of the bed.
Britta's just having a rough time because her friend's in prison.
I went to her Facebook page. It says she was tear gassed and possibly beaten. I haven't been tear gassed in so long.
Well, you're on a new path now.
Oh, goody, a new path. Is it lined with credit cards and flat screen TVs? Does it go by an IKEA? Maybe I don't want a new path, or any path. Maybe my path is a war path that leads to the Terror Dome and words. Okay, maybe I went too far. Maybe I don't want to offend my African-American friends. But the larger point is, maybe I'm not done raging against the machine.
Raging against the what? That sounds dangerous.
Don't worry, she'll be bad at it.
So as this is going on, you have Chang being instated as a new security guard.
My first cop flashlight. Can't wait to get some brains on this bad boy.
And if it hasn't been addressed already, Chang is crazy. So, as the rest of season 3 will show us, Chang being a part of law enforcement is not a great idea. In fact, 15 episodes down the road, he ends up taking over the whole college by turning it into a totalitarian security surveillance state and instating himself as supreme dictator. But in the episode we're talking about here, he's just beginning that climb, and is just a lone, mentally disturbed security guard looking for some trouble to put down.
Are you safe, ma'am? Everything okay? This guy bothering you? Huh?
Hey!
Who the hell do you think you are?
The badge says to serve and protect.
No, it doesn't.
How's my smile? Oh, man. What the hell am I in charge of?
See this garbage can? Students coming out of the library bump into it. You can serve and protect them from a nasty boo-boo.
What do I do if I see a crime?
What a security guard does. Call a cop.
Enter Britta, fresh from her rage against the machine tantrum.
Mind the can, student.
Hello. Is it me you're looking for? I can see it in your eyes.
You just got yourself a warning.
I miss warnings, pig. Do that.
So Chang and Britta face off in this episode a few more times, and it's done in such an interesting way, in these slow motion montages to this love song.
This is what the United Nations is doing to your freedom. I'm your freedom, and I'm in a cage with the world because of them.
I thought I'd find you here.
What are you gonna do? Lock me up?
Well, just give me a reason.
I'll give you a reason.
Whoa! You're coming with me.
Hello. Is it me you're looking for?
He's pulling my cage. I'm being pulled in my cage for no reason. Is anybody seeing this? Is the world seeing this? Are we Facebooking this? I did more than make a mess. I turned your whole system inside out.
And I shut her down.
It's a dance between two unbalanced and unhealthy mentalities. They both love it. They both need it, even when they say the opposite. And the mutual hate gives their lives a temporal meaning. There's so many things that this situation brings to mind and that we could talk about as our civilization continues to become more divided and binary. There's the sexual overtones to this dance and what that points to. There's the stark contradiction between the inner experience and the outer behavior, the conscious and the subconscious. There's the constant need to villainize the other side, to be one of the righteous and to prove it by condemning the unrighteous. But instead, I want to talk for a minute about hate more generally, or to use the old-fashioned term, wrath. In the long ago, but not so long ago, Christian, white, patriarchal, Catholic past, they had this thing called the seven deadly sins, or the seven things you should be very cautious about messing around with. And one of them was wrath. Why? Because wrath or hate is like love. It's very, very powerful. Whatever you attach your hate to will keep it and won't easily give it back. When it's evoked, when it's sufficiently stirred up inside, it brings repercussions with it. It makes you act. It pushes you to say regrettable things. It possesses. It's a burning fire that is not easily extinguished. And also, if you haven't noticed this already, hate makes you act very stupidly, as we'll see in a minute. So Britta keeps ramping up her protests, which are still pretty weak and goofy, until they finally get the result she wanted. Martyrdom.
What the hell are you doing?
Nothing. And you can't do anything to stop me.
Hello. Is it me you're looking for? I can see it in your eyes. I can see it in your smile. My arms are open wide, 'cause you know just what to say, and you know just what to do, and I want to tell you so much.
I knew you'd come.
You're so busted.
I love you.
But how is Britta different from the activists of the present moment? Why is she last year's anarchist? For all intents and purposes, she looks pretty much the same, but I'd say there's one very big concept separating Britta from the new left, and it can be summed up in three words. Gupta, Gupti, Gupta. I hope you don't find this too alarming, but in season 6, episode 6, exactly at minute 6:00, Britta spills it and explains what this is all about.
I can't believe I'm the one saying this. For God's sakes, we're frickin' Americans. We're talking about
freedom of speech.
It's the amendment so important, it's literally the first one they remembered to add.
White people.
With penises.
We prefer to be called people without color or vaginas.
Record scratch app.
So why is Britta talking about freedom of speech? Greendale has scheduled a show at the college with a controversial stand-up comedian. Students are protesting, and a hacker is threatening to leak the school's confidential emails if the comedian is allowed to perform. And what's the name of the comedian?
Gupta. Gupti. Gupta.
Sorry, just kidding. However, that moment was from season 6, episode 6, minute 6 exactly. So the Gupta Gupti Gupta episode is a little intense. This is later in the series, so everyone has graduated, been more or less unsuccessful in the outside world, and then returned to Greendale as either teachers or part of the Save Greendale committee.
I, for one, am glad that this is happening. What this school needs is a band of heroes, champions, willing to rise up and get all those potatoes out of the gym.
So the hackers and many of the students really don't want this goopty-goopty-goopty comedian to perform. So they leak the lunch lady's private emails to show they mean business.
My God, it's the lunch lady's emails. It's all the lunch lady's emails.
Which lunch lady? The hot one?
You mean the one who serves the hot food?
That's the one.
What have you boys been able to figure out?
Don't call us boys, and it's a unique case because it's hard to decide what laws are being broken, unless you count the lunch lady's sex life. Thanks a lot. Anyway,
this cop is a great reoccurring character.
The head of security at Greendale Community College has kidnapped the dean and replaced him with a deanoganger.
Well, when you say it that way, it sounds ridiculous.
Yeah, the word we use was doppelganger.
Look, I hate cops.
I had a real-life former cop help me with the dialogue.
I'm gonna punch you in the heart.
Real-life former cops aren't great with dialogue.
I don't think police should be heroes. Britta, pay your rent.
How's everything otherwise? Stoked for Avengers? 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 I hear Marvel got really hands-on this time. They really pinned in Joss Whedon creatively, so how could that go wrong? Okay, see ya.
So the group is ready to shut the show down, but it ends up being Britta who convinces everyone to stand up to the hackers.
Don't you hate this government? Are you even planning on going to see this comic?
Yes, pretty much, and of course not. I was planning to protest him. But I can't believe I'm the one saying this. For God's sakes, we're frickin' Americans. We're talking about freedom of speech. It's the amendment so important, it's literally the first one they remembered to add. We're the colony so high maintenance, the British gave up. We're so obnoxious, the French sent us a statue. Nobody tells us to shut up. And yes, I know that our wealth is no longer distributed. And yes, our democracy has been hijacked and turned into a puppet show about two fake parties that are controlled by a cartel of monopolies. And yes, if our votes had any real power, they'd be illegal. Britta! Freedom of speech acknowledged. And we encourage anyone who believes in freedom to attend Mr. Gupta's performance. Although, as a woman and someone with many Jewish and Black friends, I will be deeply offended and petitioning to have Mr. Gupta banned from all campuses across America. But one thing at a time. First, freedom of speech does not just apply to speech you want to hear.
Case in point, am I right?
So this, of course, goes bad for the group. Their private emails are linked to the rest of the university, and they end up knowing way too much about each other.
I read it all! I read all your crap!
Then 3G shows up, and only one student attends while the rest protest outside, and then some other stuff happens, and finally the cop character comes back.
Here comes the hacker! This is Ryan, aka String Cheese Hustler, aka Fart Mitzvah. Skull and Boners 88, Frozen Sucked, Captain Titty. You don't need to know all his names.
But the point is clear. Britta was willing to stand up for someone else's freedom of speech, even though she disagreed with that speech and was offended by it. That's what we call broad-mindedness, liberality. These are democratic qualities, and they're fading away. Why? Is it the internet? Is it making people crazy? Is suddenly hearing so many opinions too much for us to handle? Freedom of speech is a foundational element of liberal democracy. Just consider its opposite. Controlling speech. Silencing speech you don't like. Censoring. Punishing. And eventually imprisoning the opposition. These are totalitarian methods, and this mechanism has been a necessary tool of every totalitarian system. When we start down this road, it's like lighting the long fuse that leads to the explosion. It might not explode right away. But if you have any sense or know any history, you can see what's going to happen. It seems to me that once they take away rights, they usually don't give them back. Or maybe it's better to say it like this: the ones that want to take away rights are not the ones that will give them back. After 9/11, we lost a number of individual rights, the main one being personal privacy. Do you think they're going to give them back? Do you think they're going to get rid of the NSA now, or the TSA, now that Al-Qaeda isn't a threat anymore?
Prabhupada told a story about, you know, how you're sitting on a train and you have a nice seat, and this little skinny guy comes up, you know, and he's looking, you know, trying to figure out how he's going to sit down next to you, right? And, you know, you're just trying to make believe you're not seeing him. But you know exactly what he wants. He wants to sit down. There is no room. But eventually, you know, he just sort of smiles at you and then plops down. He wiggles around and gets in between you and the next person. You know, you have to make some room. And then suddenly, you know, he crawls over his little kid. And he sort of pushes you. He gets his kid down. And, you know, you're moving towards the edge of the seat. And then he brings another kid, and he gets three or four kids, and then he's got this huge fat wife. And then she comes, and then you just get up and give up your seat.
Anyway, it's a big topic, and it's difficult to talk about current events in times like these when everything seems to be changing so rapidly. Let's get back to Britta. So in this episode, Britta, who we know to be very passionate and opinionated, has shown herself to be something else simultaneously. Tolerant. I feel like this is a characteristic that also places her in the liberal of the past category, which is also the useful idiot category, to quote someone. There's a certain emotional intelligence to tolerance. When you leave others alone, you also leave yourself alone in a way. Hating on everything is one of those self-harassing activities. It doesn't feel good. It's not sustainable. It makes you tired. It's one of the reasons the group's reaction to Britta is typically something like this.
Since they're just things, I don't suppose you mind letting us take a quick look-see inside your bag.
Oh, I very much mind, Annie. There's no such thing as a quick invasion of civil liberties.
This is the everyday person's inner reaction to the complaints of the activist class.
Well, it sounds a lot less fun when you say it.
Everything does. She's a buzzkill.
I'm not a buzzkill.
Yeah, that doesn't really describe it. You're more of a fun vampire because you don't suck blood. You just suck.
But here in the 3G episode, Britta is also doing something very interesting. She's laboring to preserve an ideal. Many of her other, more characteristic tendencies are destructive. Like here.
Have you guys seen that billboard on Water Street for consensual perfume?
Oh, the man chasing the woman through the grass, and it says proven in its field.
Yeah, proven in its field, and in labs on the eyeballs of rabbits.
We should make it say that! Who's got the spray paint? No, guys, I'm serious! Doug and Janet, you're on lookout. My kid works the ladder. I will banksy that mother!
She doesn't like the billboard, so she wants to deface it. This is actually an interesting mix of destruction and creation. It's different than just wanting to tear the thing down. Interestingly, the ancient Vedic texts, the Vedas, Puranas, and Upanishads, speak of three main categories of action: creation, maintenance, and destruction. linked with Brahma, Shiva, and Mahavishnu. Of the three activities, destruction, i.e. criticism, is the easiest. Then comes creation, which is more difficult than destruction. And finally, maintenance, or preservation, which is more difficult than creation and destruction. And this is why Brahma and Shiva serve under Mahavishnu, or Krishna.
It doesn't matter what we read in the leaks or what we said to each other tonight. What matters is that right now here on this campus, the people are in charge. Not the hackers, not the media, not the cops, the people.
Let's establish a basic idea, politically and psychologically. When one goes too far to the right or too far to the left, it leads to bad things. In politics, going too far in one direction leads to totalitarianism. Communism on the left, fascism on the right, but in practice they both end up looking very similar. In psychology, when one is too left brain or too right brain, it leads to various kinds of mental health issues.
You.
No, you don't. Fine, go ahead. Mock me.
Oh, Jeff, you're gold blooming.
Gold blooming? I don't know what that means.
In fact, when one goes too far too fast in one direction, it tends to bounce them back in the opposite direction. People trying to quit bad habits know all about this. The basic idea is that there's something to us that needs to be balanced by its opposite. And this idea of health is properly linked with the idea of balance. So Britta is far left, but she's still just a little beyond liberal. She's far left, but before it enters its scary phase. She's at a place where it's still easy to agree with a lot of her sentiments. There's still balance and nuance there. Her extremism hasn't gotten to the Chang phase yet, where all principles involved have become warped and inverted by a lust for power. There's still some honest self-reflection there. So this is interesting, because when Britta gets too extreme, goes too far left, she becomes the thing she stands against. Chang. Chang is deranged. That's well established. Chang is an authoritarian. Chang is the one who is obsessed with power and who just wants power and is willing to do anything to get it. His secret joy is dominating and restricting others.
First Chang kidnaps the Dean, and now he throws himself a birthday party? It's just like Stalin back in Russia times.
Summing it up, the big point that Britta makes here in season 6 is that when you get rid of free speech, you start things down the road to Chang. And we're talking about season 3 Chang in particular, which culminates in season 3, episode 21, The First Chang Dynasty. Interesting how Britta and Chang both end up as brief supreme dictators at different points in the show. Britta's brief moment of authoritarian glory is in this amazing episode, which might be the best episode of the post-Troy era, about a new social networking app called Meow Meow Beans that is beta tested at Greendale. This episode probably deserves its own video, so I won't get into it here.
I beg you not to take this risk. You know what they say. Fives have lives, fours have chores, threes have fleas, twos have blues, and ones don't get a rhyme because they're garbage.
And when you get older, you're going to see the warning signs. Mark Zuckerberg is Fidel Castro in flip-flops. Meow Meow Beans is going to make East Berlin look like Woodstock. You take my word for it.
Diversity is one of the things joked about in Community quite often.
Hi, everybody. Well, look at this group having some kind of meeting and being so diverse. There is just boy, There is just one of every kind of you, isn't there?
Well, we are missing a pipsqueak, but we don't want one, so beat it.
How can we help?
Oh, thanks for asking. I've chosen you, Greendale's brightest, most coincidentally diverse, Hispanics notwithstanding, study group to star in our commercial.
But diversity actually exists here in this group, more than it does in its newest definition.
Oh, I always assumed your father was dead, just mathematically.
Well, Mom liked to pretend that was the case.
These are your friends, Pierce?
I don't know.
Minorities? Jewesses? And the unseasonably tan?
That is inappropriate. And maybe you'll give that more weight since I'm white.
You've got a wide brow. What are you, Scandinavian?
Yeah, Swedish.
Swedish dogs? Your blood is tainted by generations of race mixing with Laplanders. You're basically Finns.
Oh my goodness, he's like the opposite of racism.
You see, this group of friends is actually diverse because they're not just different colors. They also think differently, represent different ages, and completely different perspectives in the religious, social, and political spheres. Having a group of friends with different skin colors who are only allowed to have one socio-political opinion about everything is not diversity. It's a trick. A fraud. It's like a restaurant that has 100 dishes that are all different colors and all look unique, but taste exactly the same. That's not diversity. That's just a duplicitous version of uniformity.
Are you sure it should change? I chose Greendale over City College because of the way that one dude goes.
You know I love to be seen agreeing with you, Troy.
And getting back to the group, the spirit of friendship easily transcends differences. While remaining very radical, Britta is still socially acceptable to the group. And she still finds the rest of the group to be socially acceptable, even though she disagrees with them on many points. For instance, there's Shirley, who's Christian and pro-life, or Troy, who's Jehovah's Witness, or Pierce, who's old, in a cult, and is very, very non-PC.
Sorry, you people eat this stuff?
I've never seen that stuff in my life.
You know, you really shouldn't say you people.
Oh, it's okay. Pierce was having trouble quitting offensive phrases cold turkey, so we've created a bargaining system. We traded you people for some of his other favorite phrases.
Yeah, I really got Jewish person out of that one.
Here, open.
Believe it or not, in the long ago times of 2010 and 2013, and even 2015, these kinds of things were possible. People were big-minded enough to see beyond politics and enjoy one another. They might argue about things sometimes.
You wanna make trouble? Go to Parker Brothers. You're out!
But after the argument, the friendship remains.
Before you say anything... No, I've got nothing. Can you just forgive me? Yep. Why?
Because we've all been there.
Oh,
I'm a good dean.
Yeah.
And it's actually a very positive sign that she has some kind of self-awareness of the general cloud of negativity that surrounds her personality.
Where were you last night?
At a bar. Called it.
Who can confirm that?
Your mama.
What?
Well, I'm
What the hell, Annie?
Her name's not Annie, it's Psycho, and if I were you, I'd tell her what she wants to hear.
That's right, because if I have to hand you off to Shirley, you're gonna enter a kitchen of pain. Guys, stop it! Stop it, I did it! I framed Jeff. I'm sorry, Jeff. But why? Because I'm a buzzkill, that's why. Because that's who I am, that's my role. You guys, you create fun, and I destroy it. Knock, knock! Who's there? Cancer! Oh, good! Come on in! I thought it was Britta!
Unidimensional ideas lead to simple characters. Most of these terms leave most people behind. They live their lives outside the boundaries made for them on the internet. Britta's like this, embodying some political ideas, but not limited to them. And obviously not limiting her friends to them either. Because she's bigger than that, broader than that, and more interesting than that. And somewhere deep inside, she understands the very basic truth that getting along with people is more pleasurable than fighting with them.
We're all gonna get through this. We're all alive and we're all fine. And Britta, you're not the worst. You're the best.
Been like a loner. I'm an only child. I always just assume everybody hates me. And I think that, and I think that this show and this cast gave everybody, it gave the viewers the feeling of like their dream group of what their vision of friendship could be. And it like, it gave me personally that real life feeling of like feeling like part of a group in a way that I